Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this beautiful day that you've blessed us with. God, that we have gotten out of bed, that we are awake, we are living, we have breath, we are moving about, and you have called us to gather here to worship your name. And Lord, that is our desire, to worship you, to magnify you, to glorify you, because you are so good, you are so loving, you're merciful, and you're gracious. And so God, I pray that as we dig into your word, that you would just open up our hearts and our eyes and our minds to receive that which you have for us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. Have you ever questioned the Lord as far as, God, what is your will for my life? Anybody ever done that? Sure, we all have. We've all been there. And I think any believer that is seeking the heart of God has asked God, God, what is your will for my life? What do you want me to do? And did you know that the Bible is very specific concerning God's will for our life? He lays it out. And though you might be thinking, well, what about the detail of should I buy a red car, a blue car, a house? And no. There's other things more pertinent to God's will. But he's very specific in and through his word. And so this morning, we're going to look at the will of God. Now, this is a very broad subject as far as, hey, look, we could spend hours and people have written commentaries and books on just the will of God alone. So this is going to be a scratching of the surface. If anything, to get you digging into it, desiring a little bit more, just draw closer than ever before to Jesus Christ. So this morning, though, we're going to look at it the will of the Lord, and really two parts. So if you're a note taker, I'm going to lay it out for you. Number one, God's will for our lives specifically, as seen in his word, and that is the what. That's the what. Number two, we're going to look at how to live out God's will for our lives practically, and that is the how. How do we do this? How do we go about living, God, out your will on a day-to-day basis, a minute-by-minute basis? So let's dig in. The first text this morning is going to be 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning in verse 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning in verse 3. We'll pick up in verse 1. We'll grab a little bit more context. Finally then, brethren, we urge and exhort in the Lord Jesus that you should abound more and more, just as you have received from us, how you ought to walk and to please God. For you know what commandments we gave you through the Lord Jesus. All right, here we go. Verse 3. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you should abstain from sexual immorality, that each of you should know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification and honor, not in passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God, that no one should take advantage of and defraud his brother in this matter, because the Lord is the avenger of all such. As we also forewarned you and testified, for God did not call us to uncleanness, but in holiness. Therefore, he who rejects this does not reject man, but God, who also has given us his Holy Spirit. So the Lord, through his word, makes things very specific and very clear for us, and this has to deal with and pertain with the will of the Lord. So we're going to look at five things concerning the will of the Lord. Number one, it is our sanctification. Verse 3, for this is the will of God. So if you're there this morning and you're thinking, God, what is your will for my life? Well, number one is for sanctification. This is the will of God, your sanctification. Sanctification means to be holy, means to be set apart. It's hagiazo in the Greek, if there's any Greek fans out there. It's to regard as special and holy. God's will for your life and for my life is that we are set apart. That we are different, not weird different, but we are different than the world that we live in. The world and Satan, the ruler of the world, is wanting to guide us down a certain path. That's the path of destruction. But God calls us out to be holy, to be set apart, to be different, to think different, to behave different. And this is God's will, that we be sanctified, set apart. And then what's fascinating as you dig into it, it goes on, this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you should abstain from sexual immorality. Paul could have placed in the scriptures there any sin that you could imagine, but he brings out sexual immorality. True to that age, as it is this age, we just live in just this crazy, like, sexually driven society and culture. And it was even worse back in those days too, though. So there's nothing new under the sun, but we need to be careful. As a part of our sanctification, as a part of our holiness, being set apart for the Lord, it involves being sexually pure. That word sexual immorality in the Greek means porneo. And you guys can speak right into the English what that word is. That's pornography. But it's so much deeper than just pornography that Paul's talking about here. In the King James Version, it says fornication. And that involves all sexual activity outside the confines of the sacred marriage before God between a man and a woman. That is sexual immorality. And that is what Paul is saying. Stay away from. Be pure. Be sanctified. Be set apart. It's not just a man problem. It's not just a woman problem here. It's the children now are involved in this whole thing as well. And you know it and I know it. Even watching little cartoons or little shows, and you start looking at the way these little cartoon characters are dressed or how they behave, and you're like, man, this is not good. And this is starting at such a young age. So we as a church body, as a family, as mothers, fathers, aunts, uncles, you name it, we need to be careful with our young ones. What they're watching, what they're listening to, and I know this is so foundational, so basic, but yet it's just so prevalent in our society as it's being shoved down our throats. And we need to push back by the power of the Lord in our lives for sanctification, for purity. And it's a high calling, it's a holy calling, and it's only a calling that we can accomplish in and through the power of the Lord Jesus Christ and His Spirit working in our lives. So God's will for our lives involves five things. Number one, sanctification. Number two, rejoicing always. If you skip over to chapter 5 of 1 Thessalonians, picking up in verse 16, it reads this. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. I love the word of God. It is so clear. It is specific. The will of God is right there for us. It involves sanctification, being set apart. Number two, it involves rejoicing always. And that word in the Greek, it's kerio, it's almost like charis and grace, but it means to properly delight in God's grace. Literally, to experience God's grace or favor, be conscious of and glad for His grace. So this makes a little bit more sense because if you're like me, you go through a trial, a hardship, or a pain, or a struggle, you're not necessarily dancing around, clapping your hands, and just saying, oh, thank you, Lord, this is just so fantastic. No. You're in the midst of it. You're in trouble. You're in pain. You've got tears. You've got this stuff going on. But yet Scripture is clear for the will of God in our lives is to rejoice always. What does that mean? To be ever mindful of the grace of God in your life. That's what rejoice always means. It doesn't mean I'm dancing around as a happy, goofy Christian and all life is good. No problems ever hit me. Nothing like that. No, no, no. It's though the problems come, the trials come, whatever's happening, the pain hits. It's I can rejoice. I have the steady confidence in knowing that God is in control and that He is gracious and He is loving. One of the great examples in Scriptures I love of this particular aspect, rejoicing always, is seen in the Apostle Paul and Silas in prison. How many of you have been to prison? No, never mind, never mind. The prisons these days are a lot nicer than back then. I've preached in prisons today, and they're pretty nice. I mean, they got Bible studies and workout rooms and this, that, and the other. But imagine Paul and Silas are in prison. And so here these guys are, they're walking, they're serving the Lord, they're rejoicing. I say, God, okay, people are getting saved and lives are changed and all of this great stuff is happening and bam, they get thrown in prison. And they could be like bickering and complaining, well, God, this didn't work out. How did I get here? I mean, this can't be part of your plan to put me in prison. But they were right where God wanted them to be for this particular moment. That at midnight, it says in Acts 16:25, it says this, but at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. This is being set apart. This is living in the will of God. Yes, they are in a trial and a dark time, but there they are, rejoicing, praying, and singing hymns. When was the last time you went through a painful time or a difficulty and there you were singing hymns, praising the Lord, and praying unto Him? And so that's what they were doing. So what this doesn't mean that as Christian, life is always perfect. Everything is just fine. You know, you don't have to come in here and put on an act when you come to church and have it all together. We are all sinners saved by the grace of God and we are all a mess. And we need that grace daily, moment by moment. But we'd be real and authentic. Yes, I am in pain. I am hurting. But deep down inside, I know that God has it for his good. We don't sugarcoat our trials or our pains, but it means that we are just so reliant and so into and in tune with, consciously in our minds and our hearts, the goodness and the grace of God to get us through whatever life throws our ways. Rejoice always. Rejoice always. Number three involves praying. Pray without ceasing. Okay. Pray, that's kind of hard, right? I mean, I can pray before the meal. I pray before bed. And when things get really rough, I pray. But pray without ceasing? Lord, this is kind of pushing it. So what's the point? What's the point of praying without ceasing? Are we walking around with our hands folded, our eyes closed daily? Is that what God wants? No, not at all. What he wants is that constant communion and fellowship with him, to be mindful of his grace throughout the day, to have him there right with you in the midst. One of my favorite stories in the scriptures is that of Nehemiah. Nehemiah, of course, and the Israelites, they are taken captive, and he's having this desire to go back and rebuild the wall of the ancient city and do what God's placing on his heart to do. But he's a cupbearer for his occupation. And you know what a cupbearer is, right? That really bad job of drinking the drink before the king would drink, and if you choked and keeled over, then the king was like, well, whew, I'm not having that. That's the cupbearer. So he's there before the king one day, and his countenance is down, and the king recognized that in Nehemiah's life. Hey, Nehemiah, what's wrong? Paraphrase, read it for yourself in Nehemiah. And it says in Nehemiah 2, 4 through 5, it says, then the king said to me, what do you request? And then it says this, so I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said to the king, if it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in your sight, I ask that you send me to Judah, to the city of my father's tombs, that I may rebuild it. So the king says, what do you want, Nehemiah? And in an instant, he prays to God. And then he rolls out his request. Like, there's no, like, this long pause. Okay, well, let me go to my prayer closet real quick, and let me stand back, king, whatever. No. But what this is a picture of is that Nehemiah was, like, living in the presence of God so much so that he's in this moment, this conversation. It's very quick. It's happening. And he just throws up a quick prayer to God. Boom. God hears, answers, and off he's going to go. But it's just kind of this abundance, this knowing of God's grace and mercy in my life as I'm walking and as I'm living and as I'm just talking and I'm breathing the Lord. That's what that is. It's not this physical posture on a daily basis. That's not it. It's mindful of the presence of God and having communion with him no matter what's going on and whenever it is. And it could be just a simple, quick moment like Nehemiah. Hey, that's right on for the Lord. It could be a long prayer, whatever it is, but God wants us to pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. Number four, giving thanks. What are the specifics of God's will? Well, sanctification, rejoicing always, praying without ceasing. And then it goes on, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. I tell you what, scripture's hard sometimes because I read in everything and I'm thinking, well, I could have said in most things. In some of the things that life throws at you. But no, God covers it all. In everything, give thanks. Give thanks. That word in the Greek is eucharisto. It's from two words combined together, good and grace. So good grace in everything. Properly acknowledging God's grace works well for our eternal gain and for his forever glory. Literally thankful for God's good grace. So giving thanks. Give thanks. So we can give thanks in all things because it's bringing us to the heart of God and it's the good grace. So yes, you can be going through a trial or a tribulation and you can give thanks for his grace, for his good grace. And again, so it's not like you're having the pain, you're having a heartache, and you know, you're happy-go-lucky. That's not what the scripture's saying, but you're resting and you're holding firm in the good grace of God, which then allows you to live a thankful life, giving thanks for everything. Romans 8:28, RJ read it this morning. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose. Oftentimes, it's really easy to misquote this whole thing. Well, you know, all things work together for good, you know. But no, 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 no. It's not exactly what it's saying. For those who love God, to those who are called according to his purposes. So if you're a believer here this morning and you're going through a difficulty, going through a trial, whatever it might be, you can rest assured that the good grace of God is working in and through you. He has not left you. He has not departed you. He cares for you and he loves you. And that is our God. Giving thanks. This is difficult. This is super difficult. We need the Holy Spirit power in our lives to do this stuff. And it's not easy. And I can attest to this, it's not easy. I mean, and many of you know my story. I had going through cancer and had that, you know, a while back. But when you're in the hospital and you're in pain, it's hard to rejoice always. I mean, it's hard to give thanks. And in my flesh, I don't necessarily want to. But in my spirit cries out, God, thank you for your grace, that you love me, that you have this thing happening, this thing playing out right now for your eternal good. The thing is, in our finite minds, we're only like right here, right now. But God sees eternal, the eternal picture, and that's where we need to keep our perspective is on God, the one over eternity that has it all under his control, and therefore we can give thanks, and that is a part of his goodwill for our lives. What is God's will for our lives? Give thanks. Number five, we'll keep rolling, it's submission. We hear that word and we think, oh boy, submission. No one likes to submit. But God's will is very clear. And it says, let me get to 1 Peter here. My Bible's torn apart. 1 Peter chapter 2:18. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 18. This whole, like, portion of chapter 2 ending here and going into 3, it talks about submission. It talks about God's order for us dealing with government, for us dealing with, like, employees or your boss, us dealing with our families, submitting one to another. It's a beautiful thing. But in 1 Peter chapter 2, in verse 13, it says this. Therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether to the king as supreme or to governors as to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. Okay, verse 15. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. As free, yet not using liberty as a cloak for vice, but as bondservants of God. Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. It's Peter. Just boom, 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 boom. That's it. But this whole idea of submitting to the government that is over you. And that's what God is, this is a design. Now you might be thinking, well, what if they are putting laws out that go against God's word and his commands? Then we stick to God's word. Just like Daniel prayed when the decree was made, he shouldn't pray. We stick to God's word. If, you know, they tell Redeemer someday, oh, you can't teach out of Romans chapter 1 because of the homosexuality and this, that, and the other, I'm sure Pastor John's going to keep teaching Romans chapter 1 because it's God's word. It's his truth. So we're not straying from that. But there's an order in society. And that's what God's want. God is a God of order. And I've traveled to the Middle East, and I've seen the places where there is disorder, where there is no submission, and it is utter chaos. So we need to take this into mind and into heart, that a part of living out God's will is a part of being submissive. Not only to the government, but to bosses, to your spouse, and having that all play out in your relationships. So that is the what. What is God's will for our lives? Specifically through his word, it's those five things. But now let's get into the practicality. How do we live this out? What does this look like on a day-to-day basis for me? To find that out, turn to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. I understand we have just about an hour and a half left, so we should be just fine. Romans chapter 12. I openly confess, topical teaching, it's rough for me. I always prefer, and that's why I love Pastor John is teaching, this is the chapter and chapter, verse by verse teaching, because I'm going to pull a text out of here, but really that text needs to flow from Romans chapter 1 through 11 to 12, and obviously we can't do that this morning. But kind of the basis of Romans chapter 12 is all there because of Romans chapter 1 through 11, which deals with a lot of doctrinal things. And of course, you guys know that the Romans wrote and all of that. But here we get to Romans chapter 12, verse 1, and Paul writes this, taking all of like the doctrine, if you will, that he's given to them now, explaining God and Jesus and righteousness, salvation, and grace and mercy. Then he says, I beseech you, it's like, I beg you, I implore you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God or compassion of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service or worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So how do we live this out? We have five specific things to be in God's will according to his word as we live out his ways. How do we do this? Well, number one, we have to have the right motive. So it's not seeking God's will in some weird way to seek our own will, our own kind of favor or anything like that. It's all about him, and it begins with the motive of the heart, which we find in verse 1, by the mercies of God. This is it. This is getting to the key of living out the will of God. That number one, we have first embraced his mercy, his compassion, and his grace. If we understand what Jesus did on the cross at Calvary for us, by dying on the cross, being buried, and rising again the third day, if we grasp that, if we place our faith in what he has done for us, then that motivates us to worship him, right? I mean, our Father, our Heavenly Father has given us all things pertaining to life and godliness according to scriptures. So that ought to motivate us, that ought to compel us to worship the Lord. And that is the will of God for our lives, that we worship him. Why? Because he has given to us mercy, he has given us compassion and grace and his amazing, unending love. What compels you to worship God? Is it a friend, a family member? Is it because it makes you feel good? Is it because it's just something that you do on Sundays and that's just been a part of your life? It's got to be deeper than that. If you really want to get to the will of God in your life, moving in and through you as you're just walking each day, it needs to be motivated from this heart of understanding his mercy and that you do not deserve it. And then out of that flows this heart of love and worship to the Lord. Then Paul goes on, and Paul does not take it easy here, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service or worship. A living sacrifice. So now, back then, so for Paul, as he's writing this and to the people then, they would have a clear understanding, a more graphic picture of sacrifices in those days. The whole taking of an animal and getting the animal from the altar and killing it and the blood and the burning, it would have been very clear. But it would have been very strange, too. Probably a living sacrifice? Okay, I mean, I get the sacrificial system, but you're saying I need to be a living sacrifice. Paul's like, yeah, a living sacrifice. So what does that mean? To best understand the living sacrifice concept, let's turn to Leviticus chapter 1, of which Paul is more than likely referring to. Leviticus chapter 1. When was the last time you read Leviticus? Maybe from the reading plan you'd read it, but a lot of good stuff. Leviticus chapter 1. Now the Lord called to Moses and spoke to him from the tabernacle of meeting, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, when any of you brings an offering to the Lord, you shall bring your offering of the livestock, of the herd, and of the flock. If his offering is a burnt offering, a burnt sacrifice of the herd, let him offer a male without blemish. He shall offer it of its own free will at the door of the tabernacle of meeting before the Lord. Then he shall put his hand on the head of the burnt offering, and it will be accepted on his behalf to make atonement for him. He shall kill the bull before the Lord and the priests. Time out. Can you imagine doing this? You know, I'll smash a bug, a spider, but doing this stuff to a larger animal, just another reason why so thankful to the Lord Jesus Christ for doing what he did to pay the ultimate sacrifice for our sins, that we don't have to do these offerings anymore. It's Jesus Christ and him alone now. Verse 5, you shall kill the bull before the Lord, and the priest Aaron's son shall bring the blood and sprinkle the blood all around on the altar that is by the door of the tabernacle of meeting. Verse 6, and he shall skin the burnt offering and cut it into pieces. And the sons of Aaron, the priest, shall put fire on the altar and lay the wood in order on the fire. Then the priest, Aaron's sons, shall lay the parts, the head, and the fat in order on the wood that is on the fire upon the altar. But he shall wash its entrails and its legs with water, and the priest shall burn all on the altar as a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire, a sweet aroma to the Lord. The sacrificial system. So here we see it. And now we go back. Well, we'll stay here for a minute. But then you think about what Paul just said. You are to be a living sacrifice. It's you on that altar. You're to be consumed. So let's look at this sacrifice a little bit more. And this sacrifice, of course, is the burnt offering. The person bringing the burnt offering was expressing his complete surrender and devotion to the Lord. So he placed this costly animal on the altar. It was a male without blemish. And without blemish is important. This is an important part of the worship, that they weren't just to bring any animal. Because it really, in our flesh, we'd be like, okay, God, well, this is my livelihood. This is our livelihood as a family, and how about I give you the one that's got a broken leg or is not eating well or something a little bit maimed and less costly to me? God, is that good? No, it's not good. I want the one that's perfect, and that's the only one I'll accept. And you know what? In our worship to the Lord Jesus, that is what he wants from us. He wants the best. He doesn't want just what's left over. Well, God, I'm going to give you what's left over. I've got a little bit of time in the day or in the evening or, you know, Sunday morning. I can sacrifice a couple hours before I go watch football or whatever. God wants us all consumed. So the male without blemish, it was a free will offering. God's not forcing it, but he's laying it out there. So the worship of the person giving this animal and putting him on the altar, it needed to be of free will. Expressing a heart of love and gratitude and thankfulness for the grace of God, the goodness of God, the mercy of God. Here you go, God. This is yours. It is a free will. And again, that is what God wants with us. He wants the free will offering. He says, Brad, I just want you. I want you holy. I want you set apart. That's what I want. It's a free will offering. Our motive is that of because of the goodness and the mercy of God. The burnt offering gets its term from the Hebrew olah, O-L-A-H, olah. And it means collectively like stairs, ascending to, a going up in smoke. Completely burnt. If you were to speak out olah today, you'd get hola, hola, holocaust. Ugh. And you think about that picture of the holocaust, but burned up. So what is the Lord saying? What is God saying through Paul? That you're to be living sacrifices. This is what he's saying. It's supposed to be you. You're to go up there. It's supposed to be free will, giving God your best, and you are to be completely consumed by God. That is God's will for our lives. And that fire is going to burn. That stuff's going to happen. But God's wearing out those impurities, but he wants all of us. It is that offering, that sacrifice, wholly consumed by God. The question for us this morning, what's keeping us from living out the will of God? Is it selfishness? Is it a sin? What is it? Are we offering something to God that's just not pleasing to him? And we know it, but yet we're just like, eh. God wants us fully consumed for him and by him and through him. Back to Romans, and we'll wrap this thing up. Romans chapter 12. And it says, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service or worship. It's reasonable. What God has commanded us to do, and that is to be wholly consumed by him, is it's reasonable. How can that be? Because of all that he has done for us. What else is our response other than to simply lay our lives down at his altar for him to consume? He wants every part of us, our speech, our mind, our thoughts, our workplaces, whatever is going on. That's where God wants to be, communing with us on a daily basis. Then it goes on, verse 2 of Romans 12, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. When God indwells us by his Spirit, he's going to change our mind. The worldly influence, all that stuff, we're going to begin to notice and be like, oh, that's not good. We're going to be able to see it for what it really is. The mask will be unveiled for the darkness of the world because we have the light of Jesus Christ in us and we can think differently and we are transformed by the renewing of our mind. That's a work of the Lord in our lives by his grace. The result in all of this, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. How do I know that I am living in the will of God right now? By what we've read and by what God requires of us. Are we being wholly consumed by him? And if we are, we're right where we need to be, doing exactly what we need to be doing, all for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. Let's stand and let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. It's challenging, it's convicting, it's rebuking, it's encouraging. It gives us the right way to live, to please you, and that ultimately is our goal. That ultimately, Lord, is our aim, to please you. Not because we have to, but because we get to, out of a response of your amazing grace. Help us to do just that. Help us, Lord, in those dark times, in those doubting times, to trust in you, to embrace your grace, your goodness, Lord. May we live our lives wholly consumed for you, which is our reasonable service. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.